What I want to do is kind of take you back a little bit. If I can take you back just a little bit and go back to a few years ago, you might remember this. Remember, if you're thinking of yourself, a beach in Thailand. You're with your family. It's a beautiful day. You can't believe how fortunate you are to be in this beautiful paradise on this beautiful day. Now, all of a sudden, you're watching the ocean, and the ocean retreats way away from the shore. And you're sitting there going, huh, that's really unusual. Honey, come here. Do you see that? But all of a sudden, all the people around you, the natives who live in the area, have left, and they're running for high ground. Why? Because experience matters. Because they knew that a tsunami was coming. They knew that there was something coming that was going to be very dangerous. You didn't. So what happened? You're getting washed ashore. You saw those pictures. People being washed ashore, helplessly grabbing on to stuff. People drowning. And then, of course, they retreat so they go back out to the ocean. That can be what it feels like if you're not prepared for the next economic downturn. If you're not prepared for what can happen. It's kind of like 2008, right? 2008, everything looked really great, and all of a sudden in 2008, what's happening? You're sitting there, and Lehman Brothers goes down. Lehman Brothers. And 40 times leverage. 40 times leverage. Bear Stearns goes down. The mortgage companies go down. Bear Lynch was going down. The government bailed them out by having Bank of America buy it. Can you imagine? Huge financial crisis. Why? Because there was excess leverage in the marketplace. So now let's forward to earlier this year. Markets go up 7%, basically, in January. Now, if you multiply that out, that's an 84% return, if it did it every month. Kind of unrealistic, right? And any time we have an excess of January, you usually have a pretty rough February. It's just statistically how things work out. But what happened in February had a lot to do with some of the same fundamental principles that took place in 2008. What really took place at that point in February was the interest rates had been really low, the volatility had been really low for a long time period. You couldn't help but make money. And the markets went up and up and up and up, right? Great time. It was almost euphoria. But what took place was the 10-year treasury, which sets the cost of money throughout the world, went from 2.3 to 2.9 like that. All of a sudden, everybody went, inflation, it's coming, it's here. And people panicked, sold equities. People that were short were hedging. Excessive leverage, options. They were short the VIX, which is the volatility. The volatility has been the lowest since 1960. Been in double digits, low single digits all the way through. All of a sudden, it spiked to the highest level in 80 years overnight. There's a fund at $800 million in the fund. That $800 million fund, in 2 days, lost everything. Because it had two times the leverage on short the VIX, long the equities, and went. Then what happened? Markets going like up 500, down 500, in the middle of the day, you know. Computerized trading kicks in. You have those logarithms that take place, you have those nanosecond trades, and all of a sudden you're seeing the volume. There are 189 million transactions worth 1.5 trillion that took place in just a few days. That's what happened. I'm here to tell you that was a really good thing. We needed a 10% correction. It seemed abnormal because we didn't have one in so long. But we really needed to have it. I was hoping it would go down 20%. I really was. Because we need that, those things need to happen. We average 10% correction once a year. We average 2-5% corrections twice a year. We average a 15% correction every 2.5 years. And just about every 3.5 years, we average a 20% correction. We haven't had a 20% correction. So the further away we get from the last crisis, the closer the next one comes. And as long as you understand that it will come, it won't be a surprise for you. I received, out of the hundreds of clients I have, 3 phone calls during this crisis, this last media blow up, this last correction, 2 from the same person. And I have, like I said, so most people understand what was taking place. Most, because we communicate very, very well, I think, with our clients. Our clients tend to be pretty educated. So when you look at the aspects of what to expect from the marketplace this year, expect more volatility. I had an interesting conversation yesterday. I had, in fact, I'll have the information, but I can remember. I had T. Rowe Prices in my office. They brought one of their strategists out from Baltimore in their headquarters. He was talking about their estimates of the market and what's taking place and all the things that happened and what's likely to take place. It was a very interesting conversation. And one of the things that he had said when he was out here was that one of the things they believe, they think the 10-year treasury is probably going to vacillate this year between 10.9 and 10.6. Now, other people said they thought maybe it could go above 3. At the current level of where stocks are at, if it stays below 3.6, 3.7, stocks will still be undervalued. They'll be fully valued if the treasury climbs that high. So that's probably good news. The other thing he said, he thinks that spike in January of the inflation concerns really had more to do with the bonuses people got. There were millions, if not tens of millions, of Americans that got a $1,000 bonus after tax reform. And many of them went out and spent it. And that created a pop in that market that we normally have not seen. So with respect to that, that's two of the things that they think may have taken place as far as that overall position. But the fundamentals matter. Investing is not about the gadget play, the flea flicker. It's about blocking and tackling. It's about winning the line of scrimmage. And when we understand the fundamentals of where things are at, when someone would call in and say, oh my gosh, here's the thing with the media that bothers me, is you guys, most of you know, I call the media financial pornography. Because they really sensationalize everything. If we look at what actually they were talking about, they would say, the second biggest point drop in U.S. history. Okay, yeah, it was. But just go to percentages. It was the 38th, I think, biggest drop in U.S. history when the market went down 1,000 points in that day, in percentage points. Because if the market's 12,000 and it goes down 4%, it's $480. If it's 26,000, it's a whole different number. Think about the percentages. Now let's think about the fundamentals of the marketplace. We just passed tax reform. Irregardless of what you hear in the media, oh, it's the wrong time to pass it. It's never a wrong time to give you let the American people some more money. The process there is, they've been trying to do it for 30 years in some form, at least corporate taxes. Maybe not so much individual taxes. They finally got it done. That's a very good thing to get done. That will add, as Warren Buffett put it, Warren Buffett, who really has been no friend of certainly the Trump administration or really the Democratic Party, I mean the Republican Party, he's certainly been a lifelong Democrat. He made a great statement. He said, you know what tax reform is your silent partner. Every American business has a silent partner. And that silent partner was taking 35% of their revenue. But unbeknownst to them, it cost them no money at all. They walked in January 1, shook their hand, and said, now we only want 21%. He goes, that's going to have a profound effect on hiring, a profound effect on the markets, and a profound effect on stocks. And he's right. So we had all this volatility, we just got tax reform, inflation looked like it was coming up, everybody kind of spooked up a little bit, and it stood back. Corporate profits are hitting all-time highs. Cash on hand, corporations, all-time highs. Amount of money coming back in the United States, all-time high. Consumer debt to income ratios, believe it or not, American consumer, we always hear how bad the American consumer is about having debt. The lowest debt levels in 80 years. Maybe this is a bull market. Bull markets do have corrections. They do have adjustments, but this is a bull market. So I'm going to go through a lot of this stuff. Feel free to ask questions and stuff too along the way. And kind of give you some takes. I'll forget to say some things, so I have all your phone numbers now, so about 2 o'clock in the morning when I remember that, I'll be giving you all the calls. I always do that. I think stuff. Please turn off your cell phones. Funny story. My older son's in there somewhere. He's right back there. He's not working for me, Cameron. I'm at a school fundraiser. There's about 3,000 people in the audience. Pat Summerall's talking. It's very interesting. They tell you on the before the speech started, and he said, would everybody please turn off their phones? Lo and behold, my phone rings. But I don't know, it's mine. I'm thinking, what idiot forgot to turn off their phone? It's my son calling me to tell me the Nuggets are behind at halftime. So, if you have any questions, ask them along the way. I'd be more than happy to answer them if I can. These are the essentials that the regulators and the lawyers want to see, all the disclosures. What we're going to talk about is what happened in 2017, what other factors affected the market, what's on the horizon, and what do the financial experts think in 2018. So here it is, the 2017 review. Trump became president in inauguration in January. First time the Fed rules raised interest rates right after that. Again in June, they raised it again. In the summer, we had a little bit of a flip here because there's some tensions with North Korea. And then, first of all, North Korea is a non-factor. Okay, it's a non-factor. North Korea is not going to do anything. They'll be gone in a blink of an eye. And the only thing that dictatorship has is the power of their people. So don't panic on North Korea. China ain't going to let North Korea do anything, because if North Korea does anything, all those people are going to end up in China. And then China's going to build a wall. I think they've done that once before, but it's going to be a situation that's going to be not bad. House and Senate reached an agreement on reform review on December 13th, and Trump signs Tax Reform Act, one of the bigger acts in the history. If we look at what some of the experts think what was going to happen last year, they were looking at a cumulative nature of about a 4% growth. They missed it by just a little bit. Keep in mind, when analysts and strategists, they always want to be conservative, not aggressive. They're going to underestimate what they think is going to take place because they don't want to look foolish. So, labor market, what other factors affect the market? Labor, housing, consumer spending, corporate, and inflation. The unemployment rate. The unemployment rate has plummeted to new levels. It actually dropped about 4.1% from 4.8%. Wages increased 2.5%. Now, this is a real key factor here. You cannot have inflation unless you have increasing wages, right? Milton Friedman, great University of Chicago economist, the definition of inflation is too much money chasing too few goods and services. So while we're starting to see a slight wage increase, we had 87 straight months of job growth. They're estimating this year inflation may, or unemployment may be 3.8%. If we get wage increases to the middle class, the middle class in America haven't gotten a wage increase in 20 years. What did we do on this last financial crisis? We lowered interest rates. That's all we did. What happens when you lower interest rates? Real estate goes up. Cheaper to buy real estate. Stocks go up. Why? Cheaper for companies to borrow money. So that's what happened. If you own stocks, you own real estate, your life got a lot better. If you didn't own any of that, your life didn't get any better. If we do some infrastructure, spending and investing, ultimately, the middle class is going to get a pay raise for the first time in 20 years. Now, that will lead to some inflation because I have some very wealthy clients. I have three clients that have net worths over $100 million. And that's unusual. I mean, everybody else here, and they're like way up here. But it's mostly they own a corporation, or they own lots of real estate, that kind of thing. But when their net worth went from $80 million to $120 million, nothing changed. They drive the same car, they live in the same house, married the same woman, you have the same friends, eat the same restaurants. Wealthy people hoard wealth. But the middle class guy gets a pay raise, he's going to spend it all. And that's when inflation will come. So one of the indicators to understand when inflation comes is when wages increase. Okay, that's going to be an important factor. Job losses, unemployment, private payrolls. During the Great Recession, we lost 8.8 million jobs in a blink of an eye. We gained back 17.1 million. The economy is very healthy and strong. When we look at net job creation and what industries did it come from this last year, 5% growth in financial services and business services, information technology, manufacturing, one of the misunderstandings, let's just put it. The gentleman from highly educated Ivy League guy who was in my office yesterday from T. Rowe Price, he said, listen, all this money is coming back from manufacturing. Yes, manufacturing is going to increase in the United States. One thing about manufacturing, we manufacture more than any nation in the world, period. we manufacture more than just about the other nations combined, the top next two nations next to us combined. What happens in the United States is we're not gonna get a rush of new jobs in manufacturing. It's not gonna happen, because we're very automated. We have the technologies. When this money comes back and Apple builds a new factory, when somebody else comes in and says they're gonna build a new factory, it's gonna be an automated factory, okay? It'll be good overall for America, but it's not necessarily gonna see a spike in jobs, okay? It's just the way the nature of the beast is. So everything kind of did pretty good, so we lost government jobs. For the first time in a long time, we actually had government shrink last year. Here we got housing. This is housing. You know, I was talking to this guy yesterday, and in my book that I wrote, I talk a little bit about why I think this, I think that this is the greatest bull market of our lifetime, and I lay out the reasons why I think that. And one of the things I laid out is we're going to have a housing boom in the 2020s, and he stated the same thing. We're building houses right now at a rate of about 180 million population. We have 380 million people. Some homes are going to be obsolete because they're going to get too old. New houses are being formulated through marriages and births of children. Kids are actually moving out of their parents' basements. So that's happening. And what's going to take place with that is you're going to see in the 2020s, you're going to see this millennial boom start buying houses. Now, I got a question for you. And you don't have to answer if you don't want to. I doubt, unless someone's heard me on the radio, maybe you know this answer already. Because I've asked everybody this. What do you think last year the percent of home purchases, used and new, were from millennials last year? Anybody? I would have said 10%, 12%, 42%. 42%. Millennials are growing up. The first millennial turns 30, this guy's sitting here going, my wife, this guy's a millennial, because my wife turns 35 in 2019. That's the first group of millennials that starts to turn 35. They're going to start buying houses. I wrote that in 2014 in the book. That's what's going to happen. Because they get married later. They have longer to get past the college debt, right? They got bigger debt. They have children later. They aren't going to live in apartments downtown forever. They're going to buy a smaller house, a little closer together, a little more community, a front porch, not a back deck, but they're going to be buying houses. That will have a profound effect on the economy in the 2020s. Last year, number of sales were up 26.6%. Median price across the country, Denver probably helped us a little bit, we're up 1.2. Housing starts, 12.9%. Existing homes sales were up 3.8. Median price of 5.8. We do not have enough houses in this country for the demand that's coming. U.S. personal income and spending. Interesting number here. The deep brown line is consumer spending, and personal income is this line. They pretty much track each other, except for right here in November, consumers spent a lot more than they were making in pay increases. Now, generally, that's not a good thing. But the debt ratios of income to debt is the lowest it's been in 80 years. 80 years. There's a lot of really good data here.
Hey, Kurt.
Yes.
I have a question. So on the housing market, does that also happen? Depend upon if interest rates stay low that the millennials will buy, or do you think we'll have something where even if interest rates go up to 8%, people will still think that's a good bargain?
If interest rates go up to 8%, we're in a lot of trouble, because the government won't be able to pay us.
Yeah.
So it's going to be really hard for interest rates to go up to 8%. But if it did, yeah, that would certainly put a damper on it. And it could, for temporarily. I mean, the government's going to go back to quantitative easing or some of the things that they've done that's
over
to keep interest rates down. They'll do that because they can't afford to pay the debt that they if they can. Do you remember a few years ago when they had the crisis in Europe and everybody was all, you remember all that? If the Italian banks, if the Italian treasury goes to above 6%, the Italian banks won't be able to pay their debt. That day's coming in America. Mm-hmm. What we have to hope for is excessive growth, which generally what happens, with more money in the economy, creates more GDP, which, even at lower tax rates, creates more tax revenue. Then maybe that could happen. But yes, interest rates will go up, and I think very likely we're both going to be gone before we see 8% interest rates again, but I could be wrong. But yeah, you're right, that wouldn't make an effect. But people were buying houses. There's people in this room that bought houses when the mortgage rates were 12%, right?
Yeah.
You just real estate values are going to, interest rates go up, so real estate values are going to go down. So the net effect is you're going to buy more house for less money. You're just going to pay more interest. So that kind of stuff. That's a good question. Revenue, net income, and earnings. There's just a lot of stuff in this chart. Basically, it's all good. It's just too much to look at. I'm ADD and I'm going, oh my God. CPI, core CPI. Headline CPI includes everything. That's basically what the government, one of the measures the government uses for inflation. Core CPI takes out food and energy because it bounces all over the place. It's really more expensive. You can see the volatility of what inflation does. You can see the headline PCE deflator. That's the number the government uses to measure inflation. And core PCE deflator, personal consumption estimated. What happens is the 50-year average, this is extremely important why we don't have inflation, the 50-year average of inflation is basically right now, or half, what we have been over 50 years. The measure the government uses to monitor inflation in the 50 years is 3.5%. We're at a buck, we're at 1.5%. We got a long ways to go before the government has to get serious about raising interest rates. A long ways. Keep in mind too that we have a global economy. What did I say? When they bring this manufacturing back, it's not really bringing manufacturing jobs back. It's bringing manufacturing back and revenue, but not jobs. If income and revenues and get too expensive in America, it's a global economy today. We'll just go back to making stuff in Indonesia. And that keeps labor prices down, which keeps inflation down. So there we are. Consumer sentiment. I'm really grateful that when you tell somebody that we're in this rosy economy, and at least maybe 30-40% think it's a bunch of baloney. Because if everybody thought it was rosy, we'd be in trouble. The great John Templeton, one of the kind of the pre-Warren Buffett guys, if you will, said that bull markets are born on pessimism, they grow on skepticism, they mature on optimism, and they die on euphoria. When you talk to everybody in your life, and they think consumer sentiment, now the consumers get too confident. Right here they're very confident, right here they're very confident, right there they became very confident. These darker lines here, those are recessionary periods that take place. When everybody gets too optimistic, when everybody gets too calm, is when we usually have a recession. So we aren't there yet. Looking back, 2017, and our predictions, U.S. reaches energy independence, that's a big one. Economy takes off and industry returns to the United States. Big headlines. We're now the largest producer of oil and gas in the world. That's amazing. The United States, we have vast supplies. I've got big clients in the oil and gas business. I got a bunch of clients down in Texas. Big clients. There's a lot of stuff happening. You got bad news. Trump starts trade war. Loose lending standards trigger hyperinflation. The European Union is open. Now, one thing about America today, it used to be when Walter Cronkite was alive, you used to be able to say, don't always believe what you read, don't always believe what you hear. Today, we don't believe what we hear and believe what we read. We read what we believe, and we read what we see, and we hear what we believe. You got such polarized positions in the media, right? If you sit to the right, you're watching Fox News. If you sit to the left, you're watching CNN, and you live in a cave, because all they're doing is feeding that thought in your head. And what happens to America? They grow further this way, away from each other. And so that's kind of a process that I don't even watch the news anymore. I just can't take that. What's on the horizon? Imagine the future in a positive view. Looks like a bull to me. New tax bill spurs economic growth.
tensions with North Korea ease. Europe continues to strengthen despite Brexit. In fact, one of the hot spots of investing is overseas. The T. Rowe Price Global Fund was one of the guys who's a strategist on that Global Fund. For the first time in a long time, their allocation is 50% U.S., 50% international, and a predominance in Europe. It's a pretty big statement. Last year, for the first time, I want to say maybe 10 years, maybe not quite that long, international accounts outperformed the United States. That's a trend that generally lasts 3 or 4 years, okay? So there's some real opportunities there. If you want to be a bear, Trump indicted for obstruction of justice. America goes to war with North Korea, and the European Union is over. In other words, on Fridays when I'm on the radio, I always try to do a fun little quote. And this last Friday I said, there's been an awful lot of optimists that have made an awful lot of money from buying things from pessimists. So I think at this point, the economic data would show you to be an optimist. Here is 2008. These are all the leading economic indicators. Look at all the red in 2008. There was very few that were favorable. Interest rates going down. Monetary policy was favorable. The stocks were not overvalued at that time. But look at everything else. We had a dismal personal income. We had job creation was terrible. Economic outlook was terrible. It was a bad deal. We go to January 2017, almost everything, there's no red. Almost everything's green. A little bit of yellow, of a caution. And then we go into December of 17. Only real red is geopolitical risks. You know, we got some geopolitical risks. So when don't we have geopolitical risks? When we look here at the S&P valuations, this is a really interesting chart, at least to me. A price-earnings ratio is the price you pay for the dollar of earnings that a stock gets. The lower the P/E ratio, the more undervalued or perhaps fair value the stock may be. The higher the P/E ratio, the more expensive a stock may be. Historically, P/E ratios run around 16. The 25-year average is 16. Today, we're running at about 18.2. But this was actually based upon 2017 data pre-tax reform. Interesting happened. When they did tax reform, the Wall Street came out and re-estimated earnings for the S&P 500. They said they anticipated earnings being $160 a share. It may be better than that. They anticipated earnings. That means P/E ratio is now about 16.2. There's an interesting number as well. It's going to show up, I think, on the next page. Here it is. Low inflation. Oh, didn't show up. I have to tell you that. Go back. Low inflation, high PE. Historically, throughout time, when inflation is very, very low, and there has been times when inflation has been very low, do you know what PE ratios typically run before they get heated? The low 20s. 21, 20, 21, 22. Maybe people here have heard Jeremy Siegel on TV, your old book, Stocks for the Long Run, the Wharton Business School professor. He's been pretty right. He's been saying that for a long time. He said, listen, with interest rates as low as they are, is another way of saying inflation is low. Because remember, interest rates will stay down as inflation stays down. He said stocks will not be overvalued until they get in the low 20s on a PE. Pretty interesting. Pretty interesting statements. 2018. Excuse me. You know, that's better this is, not to give my son back your credit. I had a screen all laid up here, and you guys ought to all be kind of huddled around real tight to be able to see it. He goes, why don't you just turn the lights down and put the. It's good to have a millennial around. All right, where is inflation coming from? And what does it look like? Essentially, once again, what took place, what's starting to take place, is the real average hourly earnings are starting to go up. When that happens, now, keep in mind of inflation. If food and energy prices go up and wages don't go up, that's not inflationary. It's deflationary. Because you have less money to spend on other things. But if wages go up, food and energy go up, then you have more money to spend. Therefore, it can justify the higher prices. Two reasons why inflation hasn't been in the American economy in a long time. The last time we had hyperinflation, remember the big interest rates in the 1970s and 80s?
You know why we had that? About 46% of the U.S. population, private payroll population, was union. When prices went up, they went on strike. They got pay raises. It's proof right there of the theory of inflation. When that middle class, that worker gets more money, he can afford to spend more money for stuff. We had hyperinflation. Well, the unions got busted, they've changed, and then we had a globalized economy. We have labor that now you can get anywhere. So you can manufacture stuff around the world and get services around the world. That's the reason why wages have not gone up much and why we have that much inflation. But inflation will come back. The target for the government is to keep it below their 2% target. And if you look at the long-term historical averages of the PCE inflator, it was 3.5%. We're at 1.5%. We have a long ways to go before inflation becomes a problem. And in fact, the gentleman from T. Rowe Price said, in their opinion, January was a blurb because of that big bonus payout, and that thing was going to settle back down, and the 10-year treasury would settle back down. I don't know if they're right, but that's their thought. Huge number right here. This is a key number. So key, I have to drink water before I say it. It's kind of like when you're watching, you watch those cooking channels, you watch those cooking shows, and you want to find out who's going to get chopped. Then they turn around and you have to wait for a sticky commercial. I'm really angry with that. I'm not a very patient person. My wife key number here. Now, why can the government raise interest rates? Why do they feel like they can go out and raise interest rates? Because the economy is doing pretty good, right? So when they raise interest rates, there's a certain level to where it becomes detrimental to society, and there's a magic number. And that magic number is 5%. When the 10-year treasury historically gets above 5% and the government raises interest rates, stocks go down. When it stays below 5% and the government raises interest rates, stocks go up. Just a fact. That's this. The upside is right here. Downside is right here. Now, having said that, we have been suppressing interest rates for a long time. We haven't had a free market in interest rates for a long time. So maybe the number's not 5. Maybe it's 4. One of my favorite economists, you guys have heard him on the Ross Kaminsky Show, Brian Westberg. I've been reading him for years. And really, really great guy. Plus, he likes to fly fish, so I like him that way too. He said, really, stocks aren't getting overvalued unless interest rates get to about 3.68%. And then at the current level, they'd be overvalued. We got a ways to go. So stocks are looking pretty good. If you look here, this is the Fed rate and interest rates. The government is going to try and raise interest rates, and this is, and I say try. Honestly, there's several tools. This is, gets kind of deep in the woods, but the government, the theory is that the government needed to raise interest rates so that the next recession, they have a tool they can use to stimulate the economy. It's partly true, but they have another tool. They're paying interest on excess reserves, which means interest on money banks are holding. Banks could buy, that's the way they kept it, that's a Ponzi scheme between the government and the big banks. Back when they did Dodd-Frank, one of the deals they did was they sold all these bonds to the banks. And normally, they only pay interest on the required reserves. And they don't pay it on the excess reserves because it forces the banks to lend money. Because banks can't have dead money on the books because it punishes them when they do that. But now, what we're doing for years, we're still doing it today, we're letting banks have all these excess reserves. And we're paying interest on the excess reserves. If the government wants to stimulate the economy, we're paying interest. Because I'm a business guy, and I have a very good credit rating. We refinanced our office building. You know, my mother's been dead. I'm like 57. She's been dead 47 years. I had to go get a letter from her darn near to get a loan approved. I mean, it's hard to do that. So, it's an aspect that there's another, there's lots of tools the government has besides lowering interest rates to stimulate the economy. Wages and unemployment, wages are starting to go. Unemployment is declining. I think we just mentioned that already that, you know, we're at the 50-year average of unemployment is 4.2%. We are currently looking at a 4.1% unemployment rate, dropping to 3.8 by the end of the year. So we're doing pretty good.
Kurt?
Yes?
Tying into the unemployment rate, now not to get too political about this whole thing with Republicans and Democrats.
Yeah.
So if we're going to restrict, government policy wants to restrict inflow of lower paying jobs, we want to just have our immigration policy where only educated people bring in value to if that unemployment rate keeps on dropping down lower and lower, how will that affect the general economy?
We'll have a recession. We have to have the labor. We don't have the labor.
Right.
We have to, we have to have legal immigration and all that. And Congress knows what to do. Everybody wants to do it. They just can't get it. Here, nothing's going to change in Washington until we get term limits. They're too comfortable. I mean, that's the problem, right? They know what the right answers are. I could go there and fix that thing in a week. So could you. It ain't that hard. They're paying for their own legal fees and not telling the American people. They're keeping all their campaign donations tax free. I mean, it's such a bad game in Washington, D.C. The biggest problem we face in America is right there, both parties. So that's the problem.
But that's where we're faced with, though, as common people.
Right, sure. I mean, it's a situation where if we don't have enough labor and we don't have the labor supply coming in, we could have a problem. But we could also have a problem with too much goods.
Right.
So I mean, it's complicated. But yeah, it's a good point. What do they think is going to happen? The most optimistic thinks the Dow's going to go to 3,100. You know, when Trump got elected, Brian Westbury came out and said, if he gets what he wants, deregulation, which by the way is bigger than tax reform. Deregulating is bigger than tax reform. Tax reform, infrastructure spending. Westbury said, they call him Dr. Sunshine sometimes. Westbury said that the Dow could be at 36,000 at the end of his first term. It was 18,000 to get elected. That would be pretty ginormous. I don't think that's going to happen, but that's what he said. So when you look at some of these, keep in mind the different levels of optimism. The most conservative, around 2,300 on the S&P. The highest in Westbury's there too is at 3,100. There's three of Brian Westbury and a gentleman from another firm. Any returns, and here's the thing to keep in mind. 2 weeks ago seemed so bad to people. Number one, because the points were so big, and the media is so hysterical. That's number one. But number two, we've been so calm. I mean, nothing's happened. We've had so abnormal amount of lack of volatility. All of a sudden, we get a little bit of normal volatility, and people panic. And in that situation, volatility is very natural. The average intra-year decline in the market per year, going back 38 years, is 13.8%. In a normal year, we only went down 10. I wish it went down further. Let's get it out of the way. It's going to happen again. My estimate is we're probably going to have another maybe 10 or 15% adjustment. As we go through the year, I'm guessing the summer, only because volume was down during the summer. So if bad things happen, we have a lot of geopolitical risk right now. So if bad news comes out, of whatever form it might be, and we're going into an election year where both sides are going to throw mud at the wall, hoping something sticks. And once again, it's probably only going to be at both sides about 10% truth and 90% garbage, but that's what's going to be out there. So I think that's probably going to happen, but the average is a 13.8% correction in a year. 29 out of 38 years, though, we were up. Good, we should have corrections. You know, a gentleman I've listened to a ton, a guy named Nick Murray, he says the definition of a recession is stocks being returned to the rightful owners. Remember, when you panic and sell a position in a market downcline, you just made the wealthier guys get wealthier. The rich guys got rich because they're buyers. You can't sell something. There was nobody here wanting to buy it. Warren Buffett, right? I get nervous when others get greedy. I get greedy when others get nervous. It's a process. If you understand, I said it over and over again, you got to understand what you own and why you own it. All right. Steps to take. Keep us in the loop. Let me know what's going on. Tell us about your concerns about the investments. And make sure that your important legal documents are up to date, and that's incredibly important. I'll just go into this real quick. Two ways things pass: operation of law, operation of contract, Operation of contract overrides operation of law. I don't care what your will and trust says. If you have a beneficiary designation, POD at a bank, beneficiary designation on an IRA, a life insurance policy, it overrides what your will and trust say. I went to the Supreme Court. Quick story on that. Guy goes to college, meets his sweetheart, love of his life, marries her right out of college, becomes a school teacher. He's married 2 years, wasn't the love of his life. Gets a divorce, turns around and finds a new wife. That is the love of his life. Lived with her for 35 years. Did all of their legal documents, got done. Forgot one thing. Forgot to change the beneficiary on his pension plan. When he died, after being married to the love of his life for 35 years, his ex-wife got his pension. That went to the Supreme Court. Make sure you got that stuff handled correctly. Because that overrides everything. So, you guys got any questions or anything on any of this stuff before I introduce my friend Craig Grabo? Any questions, any concerns, anything? You can all call me later. Call me at 2 o'clock in the morning. My cell phone is out there, so I got a phone call like that the other day. It's never a good thing when your phone rings at 3 o'clock in the morning. Especially when you got three kids in their 20s, you're like, oh, goodness. Your phone's ringing, and you run up, you go get it, it's the wrong number. Oh, I'm sorry, is he here? I'm like, you got the wrong number. Heart's racing. So I promise I won't do that to you. But I appreciate you coming. I'm going to introduce Craig. Craig Grabo has been a friend of mine for a long time. Our kids went to school together. He is my personal CPA. He's going to talk about tax reform. Inside of your kit is, by the way, his handout piece on tax reform. So you can look at it. It says Tax Cuts and Jobs Act of 2018. He'll go through some of the details on that. And I think that would be a good thing. By the way, one thing I failed to mention, also inside the kit is something I think is the most exciting investment thing I've seen in a long time, and that is a process of trying to model endowment investing. When you try to model this endowment investing, endowments, Harvard and Yale, have outperformed the S&P and the average investor by significant margins over the years. So a new trend in the investment marketplace is to use this endowment models. Different managers, different asset classes, multiple styles to lessen risk and increase return. You can do that now for $25,000 is as low as you can go on that. So it's a pretty cool thing. If you guys want to talk about that, you can talk about that at an opportunity to call me. But getting back to Craig, Craig did a great job of financial planning for his son's college education. He bought him tennis shoes and a basketball. Craig's son Chase went to school with my sons, won state championship. Before some of my sons were there. By the way, I think I already said this, my three kids have won 5 state championships. So if I have to say, I'll probably say it 3 more times. I'm really proud of that. It's all from their mother. They get the farm gene from me, they get the athleticism from their mother. My wife has 4 members of her family that played pro sports, and one's in the Texas Hall of Fame. And when he died, they said he was probably the greatest athlete state of Texas ever produced. My wife said that. So Craig buys a basketball and a pair of tennis shoes. Chase goes on to play basketball, full ride scholarships at Idaho State. He's a Bengal. Riley Grabo, his younger son, goes on to Wyoming, played 4 years of basketball, full ride scholarship. Wyatt Riley led the NCAA in 3-pointers percentage his junior year, free throw shooting his senior year. Riley went on to play some pro ball over in Europe. He's back here coaching. And Chase is coaching college basketball. So, really cool stuff. So his whole financial plan is going to be behind buying basketballs and tennis shoes. Craig, Craig will give you a bit of a summary on what's going on with the tax law. He'll also explain a little bit more of his background. But I really do appreciate you guys coming, and look forward to chatting with you and supporting.